forever and ever. Amen. In the name of Jesus, our Savior, amen. Today's message based upon those beautiful, grace-filled promises from Romans chapter 3. For there is no distinction, for all have sinned and fell short of the glory of God, and are justified by his grace as a gift, through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus. For we maintain that one is justified by faith, apart from works of the law. You may be seated. Today's message has a very simple outline. It is the simple salvation solas of the Reformation. You can see the outline of the message right above me in that first ring, and the Reformation rose, and that beautiful reminder and fact of faith that you and I are saved by Jesus, by grace alone, by faith alone, by scripture alone. And that's why we give thanks and rejoice. And our outline today, much of the sermon is actually written by Martin Luther. We sing the introduction to that hymn of Luther, "Dear Christians, none and all rejoice," verse 1. Because of that price paid, we are forgiven sinners, saved by grace through faith in Christ. In this hymn that Martin Luther composed, he wrote it about 7 years after that big beginning event of the Reformation. Do you remember how many years it's been since Martin Luther posted the 95 Theses? It happened on the day they dedicated the sanctuary, actually 350 years later, October 31st. It happened 1517. And in 1523, 1524, 7 years after that, Luther wrote hymns. And the first hymn book was published of Lutheran hymns. There were 8 of them in it. In German, it was the Altliederbuch, the 8-psalm book. And of the 8 psalms, Luther composed 4 of them. And the very first psalm in the first hymn book that Lutherans ever published, it was the one we're singing, "Dear Christians, run and rejoice." And have you noticed? They had longer attention spans in the 1500s. 10 verses of the hymn. But this hymn is beautiful. I had not heard Theon words information about the hand, him information. But that's what the great hens do. Hens firm our face. They shape our face. They give voice to our praise. And in this hen formation, their Christians man and our choice. As you sing it, ask yourself, who is speaking? Is it Luther talking about his life, or is it Jesus speaking about the story of salvation? Or is it a song about you and me, about our spiritual journey? And the answer is yes. This hymn is a biography about Luther's struggles spiritually, about the story of salvation, of being saved by Christ, and the story of our faith. We sing of that story and the reality of our sin in verses 2, 3, and 4. It's interesting to note, this hymn did not start appearing in English until right about the time they built the sanctuary in the mid-1800s. For over 300 years it was only known in German. And I marvel if it's this beautiful in English, imagine the poetic beauty it has in the original German. But here in these verses we sang, despair, being overwhelmed by the reality of sin. Think of it, our biggest human issue, the biggest problem that humanity faces. It is not a pandemic. It is not economic upheaval. It is not uncertainty about the future. It is not racial division. It is not a divided nation. Those are serious and big and often bad issues. But by far and away, the most dire issue and reality that you and I and Luther faced is sin. The wages of sin is death, and that sin has broken our relationship with God. We are separated. than a holy, righteous man. And we can try some more, but we can never do enough. Luther made them one of the best at attempting to please and appease God ever in history. Luther, to the vow of poverty, he became a monk. He deprived himself of sleep. He would sleep on the hard ground with no blankets. He would pray and pray for hours and hours, trying to satisfy a righteous God. He would go on pilgrimages. He would fast. He would beat his body. And yet, it always led to one place. Not, I've done a good job, and now God will accept me, but to despair. He despaired. He became overwhelmed with unfettered anxiety. And in that despair, Luther recognized his sin. And the only way out of that sin, a Savior who has taken all of our sins upon himself, who suffered and died, not because we earned it or deserve it or can merit it, but purely out of G-R-A-C-E, grace. God's riches at Christ's expense. It's sola gratia, by grace alone. That's the only way that lost and condemned sinners are saved. Ephesians 2, for by grace you have been saved, and this not of your own doing. It is the gift of God, not a result of works, so that no man can boast. We rejoice being saved by grace, and we thank God for that gift of faith in our Savior. The sin of that journey of faith, verses 5, 6, and 7. Faith alone. That too is how we are saved. by grace, through faith, in the one that is the sacrament, the one and only Savior from sin and death and Satan, Jesus Christ. These verses speak of that Savior and the salvation he accomplished. And then they transition in verse 7 that we just sang into applying that spirit of salvation to every one of us. Notice the flow of grace, God's grace. Grace, the reservoir of our grace for our time, for our humanity, past, present, and future. That reservoir of grace, it's found at Calvary, at the empty cross and empty tomb. But that grace Christ achieved is received and believed by you and by me. That's the flow of God's grace. Salvation achieved and received and believed as a gift from God. What a beautiful gift. Summarize Romans 3:28. For being maintained that one is justified by faith, apart from works of the law. Luther lived by faith. Fascinating. A few years after he wrote this hymn, 1527, a plague, a pandemic hit Europe and Germany. They think it was the bubonic plague. It was far more deadly than the silly coronavirus. There was a high percentage of people dying throughout Germany and Europe. And even Luther's government official, the Elector of Germany, said, you should flee to the countryside and try to stay safe. Head to your basement, hide out. And Luther said, no. We will not live in fear, but by faith. And Luther said, we'll be careful, we'll be wise, we'll wash things, we'll practice the proper hygiene of the 1500s, and we'll respect the medicines of the 1500s. But we must do what Christians are called to do by faith. Love our neighbor, and faithfully share that truth of God's word. Luther has given us a pattern how to live through a pandemic 500 years before it happened here. We live not in fear, but wisely, safely, and boldly by faith. We sing the final three verses of how we live by faith and firmly trust in that word of God. Thank you. Hitherto he has stated in his verses, especially verse 10, that I on earth have done and taught thy other life and teaching. Is that Jesus or Luther? Yes, it's both. Luther simply prayed that as a sinful human being, that he said and taught and preached would be in harmony with his Savior. They are no more or no less than what they have from Christ. That firm truth, that highlighted script, the holy writings. I have here a German Bible, a picture of Luther from the 1800s, published about the time a sanctuary was built. What an astonishingly rich tradition we are a part of. But we never worship tradition. In fact, tradition does not form our beliefs. Our beliefs are formed not on opinions or politics or the changing trends or changing winds of humanity, not even on valuable traditions, but our views, our beliefs, have one bedrock, unchanging foundation, the Heidegger script, the holy writings, the unchanging word of God, that truth that cannot be changed. Even if human beings try to ignore it, or redefine it, or deny it, or even if they try to shut the mouths and silence those who would proclaim it. Thank God we have the First Amendment, free speech in America. But even if we didn't have that, we are bound to the Word of God. We are captive to proclaim Christ and Him crucified, no matter what. You and I are not primarily Americans or Republicans or Democrats. We are Christians. And we thank God today that we are Lutheran Christians, that we are first and foremost disciples who follow Jesus Christ. Lutheran Christians, sinners, imperfect, that saved by grace through faith, all based on Scripture. And we take our stand in that Word of God. We uphold the Ten Commandments. They're under attack on many fronts, by many voices in our society, by the media, by many in academia, by many in politics, by many in Hollywood. That even if we were in the minority, even if we were the only men who believed the Word of God, God plus men is always a majority. We simply are to be faithful to God, to our Savior, and to His Word. And we uphold the Ten Commandments. We joyfully proclaim that what Scripture says is true. That in Genesis and Matthew 19, where God said and Jesus said that marriage is one man and one woman until Judgment Day, we say amen to that, even if society or government tries to redefine it. Even in a Supreme Court on earth, when they say in 1973 that a woman has the right to choose whether she can terminate a pregnancy. That is a right in America. But not everything that's a right in human eyes is right in the eyes of God. God be merciful to me, a sinner. God be merciful to our nation. We have candidates running for office, who advocates, who even promote and defend that they should have a right to display a unique, separately developing human being in another's room. I never, ever meant to vote for a candidate, a man or a woman, running for the highest office in the land, who says, we can destroy an unborn human being. God have mercy on us. It's uncomfortable to hold firmly to his truth, but you and I have no other choice. For we take our stand, and we repeat with Luther, here I stand on the Word of God, on the Ten Commandments, and with Jesus, my Good Shepherd. And we pray, whatever happens, thy will be done. It's never going to be easy to be a Christian. Whoever's in charge in Washington or Jeff City or wherever, but we remain faithful as our God is faithful to us. For we are thus sinners saved by Jesus, by grace alone, faith alone, and by Scripture alone. Let us news. Here I stand, here we stand, with Jesus. Amen. We continue with our offering anthem, an arrangement of Psalm 46, the Battle Hymn of the Reformation, A Mighty Fortress.